are out only to make money. So the standard will definitely be affected because there are so many things they will not do right, and that will actually definitely affect the school. And eventually it will affect the product that comes out. The way forward is for every school. I think the government should ensure that every school is doing the right thing. Every school, including exam of practice. Now, when the schools are allowed to carry on with the exam of practice, eventually the children don't read, teachers don't teach, parents, when they have finished payment of school fees, they think that's the end of everything about school. There are a lot involved. The social media has affected children a lot these days. They don't read. Instagram is there. To go is there. All they do is to browse. And they don't, not even they are browsing to read. They are just browsing for fun. So it's a great setback. Serious one. So government should look into it. We're talking about e-learning. How are we sure that they are really doing e-learning? There are very good advantages with e-learning, but there are very ugly sides to it too. So if schools will be checked to ensure that we are doing the right things, the standard will never fall.
My name is Ezema Priska. I'm a student of First Coast Comprehensive Academy, and I'm here to review a book titled Harvest of Corruption by Frank Ogodo Ogbeche. Authorial background. Frank Ogodo Ogbeche is a Nigerian who hails from the south-south region of the country. He had his secondary education in Lagos and then moved to the University of Cross River, UniCross, where he bagged a bachelor's degree in communication arts. He currently works as a senior council affairs officer in the presidency and is both a member of the Nigerian Union of Journalists and the Association of Nigerian Authors. The summary of the book. Chief Aladu Ade Amaka is the minister overseeing the Ministry of External Relations of his country, Jakarta. He is a man donned with the garb of corruption and everything evil. The story is told about how he embezzles billions of naira of his ministry fund and how he engages in drug peddling using young ladies for his business. To carry out his various nefarious activities, Chief Ade Amaka finds allies in people like Ochuole, Madam Oha, the Chief Justice, the Commissioner of Police and the Clerk. Ochuole serves as a recruitment agent, luring young unsuspecting ladies into Chief Aladu Ade Amaka's net of corruption. Madam Oha makes her hotel readily available as a safe haven for the hatching and perfecting of the drug peddling business. The Chief Justice and the Commissioner of Police both serve as protection for Chief Aladu Ade Amaka against the long hands of the law. The extent to which Chief Ade Amaka and his cohorts carry out their various unwholesome acts forms the main content of the play. The question as to whether or not they are caught is answered at the tail end of the play. Now, the themes of the play. There are three major themes in the play. The first is the theme of retribution, which means that a man reaps whatever he sows. The second is the theme of bribery and corruption. And the third is the theme of unemployment among graduates and its evils. Now, to the literary devices. There are three major literary devices used in the play. They include personification, symbolism, and irony. The playwright also makes use of proverbs to pass across his message to the readers. Now, the moral lessons in the play. There are two major moral lessons in the play. The first is retribution, which, as I said, means that a man reaps whatever he sows. The second is virtue of patience.
Hi, friends. I'm Inka Ojo-Favor. I'm here to recite a poem titled Vanity, written by Virago Diop. If we tell gently, gently, all that we shall one day have to tell, who indeed will hear our voices without laughter? Sad complaining voices of beggars, who will hear our voices without laughter? If we cry roughly for our torment, ever beginning from the start of things, what eyes will watch our large mouth, shaped by the laughter of big children? What eyes will watch our large mouth? What ears will listen to our clamoring? What heart to our pitiful hunger, which grows in us like a tumor, in the black death of our plaintive truth? When our dead comes with their dead, when they have spoken to us in their clumsy voices, just as their ears were deaf to their cries, to their wild appeals, just as our ears were deaf, they have left on the earth their signs, in the air, on the water, where they have traced their signs. For us, blind, deaf, and unworthy sons, who see nothing of what they have made, in the air, on the water, where they have traced their signs. And since we have never understood our dead, since we have never listened to their cries, if we tell gently, gently, if we cry roughly for our torments, what eyes will listen to our clamoring, what heart to our sobbing heart?
Hello viewers, my name is Oga Happiness. I'm from First Coast Comprehensive Academy. People in all walks of life believe that corruption is only practiced by those who hold political offices. But I beg to disagree with this because corruption is an everyday thing and we all get involved in it in one way or the other. Well, for today, we're going to be looking at corruption from the aspect of examination malpractice. The health of the educational system is in shambles. Who is to be blamed? Well, this is not the time to apportion blames, but a crucial moment to propose solutions. First, let's look at the causes, then how to redeem it.
So I believe that parents are responsible for examination malpractice in so many ways. You see, when they do not keep a constant check on their children's academic performance, when they don't help them with their assignments, help them with their notes, help them with everything, you're not writing the notes for them. But your mom makes sure that they're performing very well in school. The child is likely to perform very poorly. And then when this child gets into the exam hall empty-headed, of course, he's not going to see any other way out but by examination malpractice. Also, parents take their children to school not because they heard that children from that school are coming out with good grades. But they want to know how they come about these good grades. See if it's true examination malpractice, they don't care. They just go and register their own children there. And then the child will now come out with a good grade that cannot even defend. What will now become of the future of this child? But you see, parents, it's not only embraces miracle centers, they also pay money to mercenaries to write their children's papers for them. You see, they do things that they think they are trying to help, whereas they're doing a lot more harm than good. I believe that the parents should believe more in their children's academics. The reason why parents involve themselves in academic malpractice on behalf of the children is because they don't believe that a child can actually do it. But since that no child is born a dullard, so they should actually help the child to perform excellently, not by cheating for the child. Not only that, they should censor the school that they take their children to. They don't just take their child to a school because they hear their children from that school that are coming out with good grades. They should make sure that they take their child to a school because they're coming out with good grades that they can prove.
I believe the teachers have a great role to play in examination malpractice in so many ways. They can aid the students directly or indirectly. Directly in the sense of giving them direct assistance in answering the questions. The great tranquility which characterized examination in the good old days has suddenly disappeared and has turned into confusion as the teachers now read out answers to the questions asked. They can also aid the student indirectly by turning the other way around while the students are perpetuating the malpractice. Invigilators, supervisors, and the teachers themselves are appointed to conduct examinations, compromise their integrity, while aiding examination fraud. This can be as a result of so many factors. Now, they can do this in order to get bribes from parents and students. Parents and students pay bribes to teachers in order to allow them to unleash their corrupt acts in the examination hall. This is very wrong. Now, they can also do this in order to get promoted in the office, in their respective schools. Now, what do I mean? Now, dumb schools. If the students of the school fail their exams, they will blame the teachers, and the teachers don't want to get sacked. So they teach their students in the examination hall, and I believe it's very wrong. The school authorities and the management should be more proactive in keeping examination malpractice by putting strict measures and sanctions in place. The punishment should be so great such that the teachers wouldn't want to engage in examination malpractice. Then the teachers should also teach their students appropriately and comprehensively for both internal and external examinations in order to boost the students' confidence, thereby reducing the rate of the use of prepared answers and the use of special centers. And also, there should be installation of the CCTV camera in every examination hall, which should serve as a medium of monitoring all the activities that is going on. If the teachers are aware of the facts that are being monitored, they wouldn't want to engage in examination malpractice, thereby reducing it to a minimal level. And also, I believe that teachers should not compromise their integrity for any reason.
The government is responsible for this because the screening of officials for NECO, WAEC, JAMB, etc. are not based on merit, but rather on nepotism and tribalism. The officials forge results or transfer results of good students to those who have low grade to pay. Our government do not provide conducive learning environment for students. Let me cite an example. I, as a student, sitting on the floor to listen to my teacher, I may not be able to grab what my teacher is saying, but in order for me to pass, I have to be involved in these different forms of examination and malpractice. The teachers. Our government do not pay our teachers a better take-home package. Okay, me, a teacher, not teaching my students well because my salary is not enough. Thinking about how I'm going to feed my children at home. This can make me not being compassionate or passionate about my work. Take a look at Nigeria budget. 370 billion out of 6 trillion allocated for education. That's very unfair to education. Even UNESCO recommends that all member countries should set aside 26% of our budget for education, but ours is just 6%. Solutions to this problem. I think the government should screen these officials based on merit rather than tribalism and nepotism. They should provide conducive learning environments for students. Then the teachers' take-home package should be more and better so that these teachers will have passion in teaching their students. Also, they should comply with the recommendation of the UNESCO.
Well, I believe that students also have a great role to play in examination malpractice. Firstly, most of the students engage in examination malpractice due to low self-esteem. Low self-esteem in the sense that they don't believe that they can write the examinations on their own. They believe that if they try to write it on their own, that they will fail woefully. Hence, they feel less courageous to pick up their books and read, and they go into the examination halls empty-headed and have no other choice but to resort to cheating and other alternative means to pass their examinations. Furthermore, these students also engage in examination malpractice due to laziness. They are too lazy to pick up their books, to burn the midnight candle and read their books and focus on their studies. As a result of this, they go into the examination hall block-headed, empty-headed, and have no other choice but to spy on their friends and engage in other acts of examination malpractice. Then, prepared answers during examinations is another cause of examination malpractice. Once the students know that they are prepared answers in their examination centers, they will feel no need to read, since they know that all they have to do is to go into the examination halls, purchase these prepared answers, and use them as a guide during their examinations. So this is another cause of examination malpractice in today's Nigeria. Finally, some of these students engage in other practices that will not benefit their life positively, like internet, like browsing on the internet, like chatting on social media. Hence, they have little or no time to focus on their studies. So as a result of this, they don't have enough knowledge in order to pass examinations, and they have to engage in other acts in order to pass their examinations. Firstly, I believe that those students should build their self-esteem. If they build their self-esteem more, they will be more courageous to pick up their books and read, and they will not focus on other people as sources of answers during examinations. Furthermore, the student, the teachers, the invigilators, the supervisors should be more vigilant during examinations in order to catch any offenders and in order to ensure that they are punished accordingly. If this is done, these students will serve as a deterrent to others and reduce the rate of examination malpractice. Then preparation of answers during examinations should be banned by law, and any examination center or any school caught in this act should be sanctioned appropriately. If this is done, examination malpractice will be reduced drastically. Then the students should reduce the time that they spend on the internet, the time that they spend chatting on social media, and should pay more attention to their studies. If this is done, examination malpractice will be reduced.
In all, as you can see, we should try as much as possible not to get involved in examination malpractice, because if we do so, this will not only improve the educational system of the country, but will also reduce the rate of corruption in the country. Those were the views of the masses. Keep watching.